Really enjoying it. It was easy for us to watch the game together because we didn't want to tease with ours, so we, so we didn't have to worry about, you know, getting upset or anything, you know, so we didn't care who won. All right,
praise the Lord. Distractions. That's when Pastor here calling you. Maybe we should have just spoken in tongues. Maybe they wouldn't figure out what was going on. It was something reading about my Bible today, all my notes, my notes and everything. I don't know. It just disappeared. That's the weirdest thing. That's a very strange thing. I don't know if it might have been, you know, after having a celebration of your wife's anniversary yesterday. You know, all that, and a lot of things going on. Like I say, still, these jobs are pretty busy out there. And as a matter of fact, this evening, I was pretty late getting away from there. And, I just, you know, believe that at some point in time, it'd be nice I've saved my lifetime, but I believe that all things are possible to him to believe, you know, that you know, God positioned, you know, things to where, you know, the people that he have in place will be in place. And we'd be able to, you know, just the finances would be there. You know, to undergird the different ministries that whatever God has available for any particular body. We know the money and resources is in the earth. You just got to figure out how to latch on to it and trust God to move and position us to where he can give what he needs to us, and so we can position ourselves to go forth on what he has for us to do. And but I'm not going to make no excuses. God is still good. I mean, he's still faithful. His blessings are still abound. And I try to use my little phone and put notes on this thing here. And maybe I should have had my little 5-year-old grandson. He'd probably figure out how to use this thing a lot better than I can. I'm still learning how to, you know, get into this technology age. And I mean, when I was coming back from friend's funeral, and I had, I think, some young guy that was sitting next to me. Yeah, you know, I guess they got a certain time that they, you know, how they tell you to turn your electronics off and so forth. And I guess once you get a certain altitude, they allow you to utilize, and I mean, he pulled out his iPad once we got where we needed to go, and commenced to play, you know, his games, and, you know, Brother Wayne wanted to do it just kind of relax and maybe catch a little nap in between. And boy, he was just a bucking and a jumping. I mean, he was really, I don't know if that's the nervous, no, just playing a game. I mean, he really was deep into it. I mean, of course, he was sitting in the middle seat, but on the outside seat, you know how you try to, you know, battle for the armrest of the seat. Because I guess I just concluded I wasn't no match for him. He just decided I just get an armrest on up to him. Let him enjoy his game. Hallelujah. But Like I said, God has been good. He is still faithful. His word is still true. And he's still doing wonderful things. And we just had to continue to trust him to work in our lives and do those things that he has called us to do, and not to, to walk in fear. Because my first thought was, well, I can't find my notes and my Bible to see. And I said, well, maybe I just stay home. We got plenty of saints here to know how to carry on regardless. And because we all been, exposed to the word so much, Pastor had a lot of faith and confidence in us that he can entrust in even one of us, with the word because of our fellowship with the word. The Bible said, if his word abide in you and you abide in him, hallelujah. Glory to God. I know that scripture they can ask in that according to will. But if his word abide in you, the Bible said you can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. Hallelujah. That means that either one of us, because of the word, that we've been exposed to the word, and through God's grace and his strength, praise God, can stand up here. Like I said, in time past, I still remember the younger days how to stand before people who've been just one of those things that just totally, not my cup of tea. I just kind of like everybody else, low-key, we just want to sit back there where you at. But I had my chance. But through God's grace, he positioned us and he gave us those things, those gifts and talent that he gives to us. We want to use them for his glory. And I thank God for Pastor Hill and Sister Hill that, they encourage all of us to actually, and pull all those gifts and talents to the forefront. Because you never grow if you don't use those gifts. And those gifts that he gives you, he wants to bless you with more. But if your talent or gift or whatever that he placed within your life, and then you don't use it, you kind of sit back on it. The gifts and the call of God without repentance, he's not going to change his mind about what he gave you. you might decide that you just want to sit back and hold and kick it to the side, lay it to the side, but he's still holding you accountable for it. Yeah. Glory to God. Because you don't want him to tell you that you call you a slothful servant. Mm-hmm. Praise God. And God has been good to all of us. Amen. Hallelujah. He has blessed us tremendously. In our lives, I know each one of us have a testimony of God's goodness and how he has kept you and what he has done in your life. And even in my life as well. And I see things that God has blessed and continued to bless. And for me to just hold back what he has given me and what he has blessed me, it just seemed like it would be a terrible sin that God had graced me with so many different things. And sometimes I do get caught up in trying to do different things. And it seems like, you try to expand yourself with your different gifts and talent. And this one guy who told me at work, he said, man, you got a very unique gift in locating things. I know. Little folks have been to my house, so I'm not ashamed of it anymore. It is what it is, But I have to pray to God give me structure and organization, because sometimes I just get caught up in doing so many things, and you never, finish the task at hand. So things get kind of shoved to the side, keep moving on. Mm-hmm. But I really believe that, God has given me unique gifts in certain areas. To help benefit me financially for my family. And the Bible says your gifts and the calling will make room for you. And so even in your life, sometimes you have to evaluate. Sometimes you allow the enemy a lot of time to make you think that you don't have anything to give. And the Bible says he's accused of the brother. He constantly want to remind you that you're not important. and that what you put in into the kingdom of God is not, you know, needful. Because rest assured, someone is watching life and seeing you, praise God, on a daily basis. And your life is being read by somebody. So it's important that, you know, that we live accordingly and continue to position ourselves to where we can bless others and help others. Because in your world, wherever you're at, there's got many opportunities for you to share Christ. It's not always, you know, going out into the street, into the venue, which that's what we are called to do. But it's right there where you work, in your world, that you're dealing with people. And you never can underestimate, you know, because I would keep thinking about my brother, how a lot of times you would see him, you would think, well, if you ever have him went down to the store and, you know, where he kind of hang out, you would think, well, it didn't like, seem like he didn't have a whole lot to offer. But, and as now, I have one guy that constantly even call me, you know, maybe like every 2 weeks, and because of, you know, his life was been touched, you know, by my brother being ministering to him and sharing with him and talking to him, being a friend to him. And he just kind of just told me, well, he was like a brother to me. I mean, he, you know, he really impacted my life, and not only his life, it was other people's lives as well. And this is something that I was, you know, that was coming to know him that I didn't even actually know. And like I said, the guy called me, that's about every 2 weeks. He said, man, can I just call and talk to you? You know, and, you know, just continue, you know, tell me about some of the things that my brother important to his life. And like I said, you just can't, you never know, you know, even your own family, different people that you might have that seem like, well, it ain't nothing going on for them or nothing. But there are some people that are in their life or in their world, they are making an impact on. And likewise, with your life, wherever you may be, you've been called to make an impact on life, and mainly for the cause of Christ. And so we have to live accordingly so we can do that, and mainly to draw people to Him, to Christ, so He can, you know, do the work in His life that He desired to do in their life. Hallelujah. And not only that, this other friend of mine that I had went to the funeral with, if I can remember, I remember this brother called me, because I knew he had, you know, been sick, you know, quite a while. And when he had passed, I'm just going to talk to you, if you don't mind. And he called me and told me about it, that he had passed and so forth. Because the thing, and then actually, it was so strange that when he told me, he said, man, I wish you could really come. And then I told him I'd think about it and see if I can, you know, make some arrangements, and I'll, you know, try to be there. And then as I got to thinking about, you know, and looking back on my life when I was young, probably just right, I got out of high school or whatever, a teenager, growing up. And I remember, especially his mom and dad, they all were friends with my mom and dad. And his mom in particular, I remember, she would just pray for us. Even I hung out with him, you know, quite a bit, and especially even sometime I would go over there and stay, and I would actually wind up staying the whole weekend. You know, they just treated me like a son, and, you know, taking care of me, and I would get in trouble with my parents because, you know, of course, you know, I would supposedly come back home. I would go over there at Friday and before I would come back home, but I wind up staying the Saturday, you know, stay there Saturday, and then Sunday rolled around, and I would just actually stay down there, and I wind up catching the bus to school from there. But they, you know, they knew who I was. I was in, you know, good company. But I can remember, you know, like I said, the mother, you know, praying and laying home, because my little son would be sick. And she wouldn't feel it too good. And I remember being around him, and she would just start praying, and she wouldn't speak very loud, but she would lay hand and just start praying. And I'd be sitting there. And then she after she got through praying for one of the sons, she said, you feel better now? And she said, yeah. And I'm like, whatever you gave me, you know. I wanted that. You feel good. I wanted to feel good too. And she would reach over there and lay hand on her and pray for me. And now, you know, some thing that she, you know, like I said, you can see how your life being impacted. I can see how my life was being impacted. And how some of the things that she spoke into existence, even in our latter years, I would go down there and she would be down another house. And I remember she would tell me about my brother, she said, and she told her about, she would tell me about one of her sons, how he had gotten saved. And she told me, she said, tell Troy about this one, you know, son called Charles, tell him about him. And she said, God is going to save Troy. Exactly what she told me. I mean, this is in her latter stage, she still, of course, she recognized who I was, but, you know, she still, you know, was, you know, sickly, but yet, you know, she was still recognized. I can remember when she would take us to church, and they, back then, you know, they believed in with the channeling, and then loud music, you know, and jumping around. Like I said, I remember all of that taking place, you know, as a teenager growing up, and how she would, they would call us down, all down, and pray of us well. And that left a, you know, major mark in my life. And I thank God for the experiences that I had and missed it among that family. And you said, why share all that? Because you don't know, like I say, the calling that you have in your life and the people that are around you. And you're praying for them. You're encouragement unto them. You minister to them. Because sometimes you think, well, just taking have a Bible, just, you know, a lot of time and you know, and just teaching the word to them, all that. It's just being a friend. Just being a friend. Because, you know, when I look back, that's what mainly these guys, it was about three, I think about, you have three brothers, basically. And like I look back, I didn't even have transportation. As a matter of fact, this particular guy, every weekend, every Friday, he would come pick me up every single Friday. And we would just basically hung out together. Now, by, you know, certain term, you would think that in today's term, it might have considered a bad influence on my life. But they showed me a real true friend. Cause when, you know, when I go down and amongst them, I can show you how God has been so good to me. Because one of them has been paralyzed, me and him about the same age, where he worked in the woods and wound up suffering a major hip injury. And as today, as of right now, he probably is, you know, for us walking, he probably, when I mean talking about an inch at a time movement, this is how he walked. And then another brother that I hung out with, because he was exposed to drugs so much, is he was actually young I am, has wound up damaged his brain. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And then, like I said, the brother that just passed, he probably just only 2 years older than me. I want to say God has been good to me. That's why I made the, you know, the special trip to go down there. And the thing that I make my attempt to do when I go there is to go by this one particular brother's house, the one that barely can walk, and just share with him and talk to him about the Lord. Because, you know, God has given us and blessed us with something to give unto others. I mean, you sometimes can say the devil will try to beat you up through your circumstance and through your situation. And, I mean, through, like I say, sometimes through job, through your health, to get you so more focused in on yourself. The word you don't, you get so busy in doing things that you don't have time or you don't feel like it. But you have to stretch yourself for somebody else to be able to share the gospel just to help and encourage them. Because they need to know somebody loved them. And the Bible says, by this, they know that we are God's disciples, that we show love. Not that you're expecting, that's the thing about love. Love is not expecting anything when you return. That's why I got to look back. I didn't have anything to offer this guy. He came out here and picked me up. He showed love for me. And at that time back then, he had a 1964 Chevy. And they put this label on us. They call us a 64 gang. And one of the worst things that I remember we ever doing is, I think one time we went downtown. Well, downtown, it was a small country town. Went downtown, and we turned over some trash cans. And we went down the neighborhood, down back over there to their neighborhood, and we took the trash can for that individual, we moved it over to another person's. I mean, you know, what else do you do? So we do what we did, do anything, you know, anything nothing major bad. But like I said, the gift and the calling of God on your life without repentance, that gift that God has placed in you, He wants you to share it with others. He wants you to minister to others and impact their life. And like I said, these individuals that I just talked to you about is still almost seen in their life what we call didn't have nothing to give. But yet they do, and yet you do. Praise God. But you have to avail yourself to those individual lives. Whatever you feel in your life that God has called you to do, to minister to others, right around in your circle, because they'll be your mind. The Bible says we are epistles read by men. They might have never picked up the Bible. They may not never even go to church. Praise God. But you look upon us to encourage them, you know, to point them to Christ, which is the ultimate call. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. And this one particular guy and his son played football in Green Bay Packers. And I finally got a chance to meet him. But then again, I didn't know that there was several other sons that I remember one of the sons, but I didn't remember the other son. I mean, very nice, you know, because, I mean, I know you all don't know this individual, but I call Charles. He was pretty, you know, Charles, he was pretty rough dude. I mean, he didn't mind telling you, you know, what he thought of you, you know, something good. But yet he had a heart to where he would take, you know, now this is just me. He did some other guys out there to try to help. But I can remember when I was back at home, as soon as I got out of high school, you would think the first thing was to come to Tulsa. Well, my sister Helen was. But that wasn't my first choice. He drove all the way from Houston and came to Luther and picked me up, you know, and took me out there where he lived. help me get a job. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's why someone decided to make an impact on somebody else's life. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And that's the same thing we can do, what I'm saying, for ourselves. Every situation might be different, but whatever God has called you to do, that you do. Hallelujah. I mean, but all that he was doing wasn't necessary for the wasn't for the kingdom of God. But his desire and his love for me as a friend, you know, motivated him to do that. And then it blessed me. But my life as God began to, I always said somebody had to have been praying for me, because all the experiences that I experienced when in Houston, it drove me away from there. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I wonder if it might have been his mom praying. I wonder if somebody had to have been praying. Because we was actually having a good time. But I began to see things begin to turn. Things begin to change. Some negative things started happening. But they want to put me in jail one time. You know, Brother Wayne got sick. Thank you, never do anything bad. It just seemed like, you know, things began to turn. It began to turn me away from that place. And then that one particular brother, he decided to come back, go back home. Praise God, and I jumped on the bus with him. I'm going back home. Glory to God. And that's when my heart began to being pulled towards Tulsa, and I wound up coming. And hell, I'm beginning to bless me, you know. And then when hell began to bless me, then somewhere in between there, I met Sister Wayne, started chasing after her. Lord, hallelujah. And of course, the rest of the story here, she wound up here. I'm just being keeping it real. When I first showed up here, I wasn't coming here to church. God used whatever he used donkey, he'll use whatever you need, whatever you want to use to get you. Then I started hearing the word being preached by our pastor here. You know, he was, you know, back then he preached a fire brimming, listening to me, preach repentance. You need to be saved, you need to be delivered. Repent. Praise God. And then every week I would come back, you know, after they would take me back upstairs there, and I began to see these brothers being saved, they start getting the Holy Spirit. And all I know, but I began to turn a little bit from Sister Wayne to what they was getting back there. And whatever they were getting, I was saying, I want that. I hear these guys come, they leaving there, they were speaking in tongues, and I would go back there, nothing was happening. And that frustrated me. And then the next Sunday, they would have an altar call, guess what? I would come down here again, just to get back there so I can get whatever they was getting. I mean, I wanted that. And that what anything I wanted, I found there, because you know it was the Holy Ghost. Yes. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The Bible says, blessed the man that thirsteth for righteousness. Yes. For he shall be what? Filled. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And that's just even the same thing now. If you thirst for him, if you have, I mean, you got a sincere desire, God's gonna give you that what you desire, that what he need for you of the most. Because at that time, it wasn't Sister Wayne that I needed the most. Hallelujah. But after I got him, glory to God, then I got her too. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. And there has been 31 years. I'm just still happy about it. Glory to God. I mean, God knows what you have needed. I mean, He really do. And once you line up with what He has for you, after I saw start seeking after Him, then He gave me that which I needed. And that's what I desire. But He turned my attention towards Him. Like I said, through all these experiences that I have with these other guys, because He let me see that side of life. Because now, you know, I began to see another side of life. Of course, in my family, my mom and them, they sent me to church and made sure that we got exposure there. And I still remember those days as well. How did that impart and impact our life as we grow up? Praise God. Hallelujah. And then thank God for that seed of righteousness that was placed in our heart when we were young. And God has something to work with as we get older. Because sometimes we think in our own, you know, kids' life, and you wonder, well, when things going to really transpire as we desire. But we have to understand, you know, we walk by faith and not by sight. The Bible says, oh, no, nothing to man but to love him. You continue to love him and show him kindness. Praise God. And begin to continue to encourage him, admonish him to live for God, but not beat upon them. Hallelujah. God's word is true. In respect to what I had mentioned the other last time, when about the salvation of your household that you believe in God for, this word is true. He said, if He promised in the word that He would save your household. I mean, we have to rest in that and know and assure whatever promise of God has made available to you, that He is able to make it come to pass. Yes. Hallelujah. And like I said, the just shall live by faith. Yes. Trusting, knowing, and relaxing, and that confidence that you got a God is able to make whatever He's promised come to pass. But as you begin to move, continue to just do those things, do them good deeds that what He called you to do, ministering to people, you'll find yourself being blessed by Him. Mm-hmm. And those promises that He has placed in your life, praise God, and those dreams, they become fruition, come to pass. And I know my wife, she had been praying, talk about crew. That's what we've been working on this thing for. Oh Lord Jesus, here recently. And you know, we finally trying to put it all together. Matter of fact, she called me this evening before I left. You know, this is something that we ain't never done before. And you know, and I guess she just really been praying for it, praying about it. And you know, and I would believe that, you know, it's been to come to pass. But that's just her prayer.
That's right.
I tell you, what Brother Wayne's prayer. I mean, I'm more of a inland man, you know what I mean? Some solid foundation. But her prayer is prevailing. You know, whatsoever you desire when you pray, believe. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I mean, this is her prayer at work. Hallelujah. And my prayer is one day that God will move in such a way in my life and bless me where I don't have to be tied to no job. Because, I mean, when you look back in the New Testament church, they had everything they need to sustain the people in the gospel. I mean, there is no lack in God's kingdom. There is no shortage. As you look around you in your circle, wherever you may be, your friends, don't let people tell you about what's going on in the economy. It has to be a part of your life. Because I still see people who carrying out their dreams, moving forward in the old and whatever so thing that they desire. But there is something that sometimes begin to tell us, well, we need to, well, we better put things on hold. We better put things on the reservation. We better wait for this. Because we know that the enemy is at work, because look what's going on here tonight. People just being lured to sleep. We can rest assured we're still in the last days. We're in a dangerous time. And we know from the word of God that Jesus can return any day now. Because sometimes we allow circumstances to turn us to the side or get our attention on something else. But the whole thrust of everything that you're doing, whether you have what you have or what you don't have, is still sitting around and preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And I believe that God has the resources for this house and for your house to carry out whatever mission there is. And we just have to pray that God position us, because if you look back at in the old system, they had more than enough. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, we have heard it before, the most prosperous people there ever lived. Most blessed people. Because as we pray and seek God, I know it's not about praise God, seeking God for finances. But rest assured, one thing about it is a necessity of life. The gospel calls money to go forward. It costs money, praise God, for Brother Wayne to be able to be released from his job to carry out his call. Sister Hank with Sister Wayne required me still to take care of my bills. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I know she loved me for 31 years. But I know. Hallelujah. She didn't want me to go and grab a box and to go sit outside there and stand on the corner with a bucket. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But I know our God is capable of providing whatever we have needed. The resources are there. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. How do I know it? I've seen it time and time again in the scripture, where God provided for every one of his ministers and the people of his kingdom. Whatever mission there was been set forth for him to do, he made sure there were resources for that. There ain't no different than it was then. We still serve the same God. And from what I've read, the scripture said he got better promises, better provisions. Hallelujah. Then if things did better, then it ought to be what? Better. Thank you, Bob. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I guess they say, where's the scripture that? Hallelujah. But I think if you heard me, I think I quoted several scriptures already. Hallelujah. My God is able to supply all. Hallelujah. All of them. All of them. That's the kind of God we serve, no matter what it is. Hallelujah. You feel in there. What is that need? I don't know. Matter of fact, I don't want to know. But you know, you let God know about that need. Allow him to fill it. Praise God. Hallelujah. And it's not, you know, it's just like I was saying, Sister Wayne wants to go to the crew. That's not my desire. But she know God knows what her need, what her desires are. And as she seeks him, He would bless her. And all Brother Wayne could do was just got a line up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. For the blessing of the Lord make you rich and add him no sorrow. I'm saying the blessing of the Lord make him rich and add him no sorrow. Now, if you got a blessing you thought that from the Lord that's giving you some sorrow, I ain't talking about your husband or your wife, hey. But he can change that too.
Yes.
Thank you, Bob. Hallelujah. But you have to allow him to give you the wisdom.